Well, hey there, everyone. My name's Brady. Welcome to Celebration Church, and thanks for spending part of your weekend with us. In just a few minutes, our band is going to get our service started with a few worship songs. Lyrics will be up on the screen so you can sing along and engage however you feel comfortable. And then our senior pastor is going to be out to share a message with us. If you have kids with you, we want to let you know that we've got a fantastic kids program happening throughout the entire service. It's safe, it's secure, and most importantly, your kids are going to have a blast. There's still time to check them in. Just head over to our kids building next door and you can check them in there. And we're gonna get our service started in just a moment, but before that, we'd like to take a few minutes and tell you about some things coming up for you and your family around Celebration Church. So check this out. If you're new to Celebration Church, Next Steps is for you. Next Steps is all about getting you connected and growing at Celebration. It's a 4-week course that runs every Sunday at 11:30 a.m. and takes you through 4 steps that will connect you with your relationship with God and community here at Celebration Church. The class is 40 minutes and childcare is available for your kids. If you'd like more information or would like to attend Next Steps, head out to guest services in the lobby and you'll see a sign that says Next Steps. Someone's gonna meet you there and direct you where you need to go and answer any questions you may have. Connect groups at Celebration Church are about 2 things: connecting people and growing faith. Groups are preparing to launch at the end of September for the fall semester, and right now you have the opportunity to sign up to be a host of your own Connect group. If you're interested in hosting a group or would like more information, fill out the Connect group host application at celebrationedmonton.com. Hey, thanks so much for being here with us today. Let us know if we can help you in any way while you're here, and be sure to connect with us at guest services in the lobby as well as on social media to stay up to date with everything happening at Celebration Church. Enjoy the service and have a great Sunday.
Reaching beyond the skies, running deep, stretching wide. Celebration Church, everybody, and especially welcome to you who are watching online. Let's turn around and greet some of those people around us, shake some hands this morning, and then have a seat.
Awesome. You may be seated. Again, welcome to Celebration Church, and especially if it's your first time joining us today, welcome to church. Today is our Back to Church Sunday, and our launch of three services. So we are having a great day so far. First service was awesome, and so thanks for being here on this semi-chilly, going in the wrong direction with the weather kind of weekend. We're so glad you're here. If it's your first time joining us today, there's something in the seat back in front of you we call our Connect Card. And what that is just a great way for us as a church to get to know you a bit better, how you found out about the church, that kind of thing. If you have any questions or concerns or anything like that, you can put that on that Connect Card. And what you do with that Connect Card is head to our guest services in our lobby where they want to meet you, and they have a gift for you in return for that card. And in that gift, there's some coupons for our cafe to get some free coffee on us today.
Yeah, and if you're new to Celebration Church, we have something special for you every single Sunday. It's called our Next Steps class. And Next Steps is all about getting you growing and connected in Celebration Church. And also, we believe that God wants to not only change your life, but also give power to your life and to use your life as well. So Next Steps happens every single Sunday. You can jump in at any time, but today is a great day for you to jump in and step in today.
Absolutely. With the three service change, Next Steps time has changed to 11:15. So that's happening in just a few minutes. And so what we would love to do is, why don't we all jump on our feet? We're going to continue to worship in a second. You can jump back on your feet, because here's what we want to do. The emphasis on Next Steps is so big that we see it as so important for your walk with Jesus, with your walk with God, that we would ask, we would encourage you to actually leave this service to go to Next Steps to watch online later, or you can even come back for the third service. So what we want to do is we want to make room right now for people to leave. I'm going to head there right after this. There's somebody at the banner at our guest services right now that want to meet you and help you find your way to Next Steps. Today we're on step one, which is all about Celebration Church, where we've come from to here and where we're going, our pastor's vision for where we're going. And so we would love you. There's childcare provided. Obviously, your kids are in class right now, but afterwards. So if you want to head to Next Steps, right now is the time to do it. We are about 5 minutes from starting, so you can leave this service right now, and we'll meet you at the banner to take you to the class. Other than that, we are finished. So the band, let's continue to worship.
His brow, a crown of sorrow. day he comes in glory to reveal the fullness of his reign.
Come on!
Our hearts will bow before the sound of Jesus' name. Oh, the cross of Jesus Christ.
thank you that your presence, Lord, fills our lives as we worship you, as we turn our attention to you. Lord, no matter where we're at, no matter what we're facing, we thank you, Holy Spirit, that you're here to speak to our hearts, to speak into our lives, to give us answers, to bring hope where there's discouragement, to bring vision where there's doubt. And we thank you, Father, that you're here to meet the needs of our heart and to lead us into your purposes. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Well, good morning, everybody. You may be seated. And we welcome you to Back to Church Sunday. And, you know, we kind of coined that off of the fact that, you know, we're at kind of the end of the holiday season that typically we engage in over the summer, where we're here, there, and everywhere. And now it's like, okay, we're kind of getting back into life. Our kids get back to school, you know, all those kinds of things. But I want to sort of just say a little bit about church before we get into the word, and that is that Back to Church, what it's all about, it's not about an event. It's not about, like, you know, coming to a Sunday, but it's acknowledging that church is something that we embrace as part of our family. It's just part of the week. This is what we do. Church is not just a service to attend, but it's a place to belong. And that the importance of our consistency in that is for those who are on a spiritual journey. Maybe you're here and you're like, man, I'm just checking out Christianity. Welcome. You belong here. And this is your opportunity just to, like, sit on the shores and kind of watch what goes and learn and get involved. But it's a great opportunity just to watch and learn and to allow God to grow you where you're at. Maybe you're someone who's here who says, well, I'm a believer, but I haven't been really regularly involved in a home church. And this is your opportunity to really grow your faith, to really see it go from just a decision to changes in life and engaging Jesus and his purposes for your life. Those are great things. But, you know, the other thing about Back to Church and for families especially that I really want to encourage is what you are doing by sowing the seed of God's word into your children is huge for their future. Absolutely huge. Let's face it, they're getting stuff sewn in them all week long, coming out of the television and whatnot that's going around them. But studies have actually shown that children who actively engage in a faith community on a regular basis are rewarded with significantly reduced likelihood of life problems, of risky behaviors, you know, and stand to significantly improve their odds of a happier, healthier, longer life. Just because their parents were willing to say, we're making church a part of what we do in our family. The Barna Research Group discovered that a person's lifelong behaviors and views are generally developed at a very young age, particularly before they reach teenage years. And their moral foundation is developed often before about the age of 9 in terms of what they believe about truth and integrity and meaning and justice and morality and ethics, all of those things. Parents are establishing a moral compass in their children by engaging them in Sunday services. As they hear the word of God, they're not people who are going out with a blank page, but they have that moral compass inside of them that says, this is true north. This is right. This is wrong. I can make those decisions. Those are clear in my mind. The other thing is this, is that we're actually giving our children the tools to deal with life. I wish we could protect them from every problem that they could ever face or any challenge that they could ever face. But the truth is we don't get to determine that. You know, that's not predictable. We don't know totally every challenge and obstacle and thing that will happen in their world. But what we can do is put God's word into their life and a relationship with Jesus and the understanding that when challenges happen, we know how to take them on. We know how to handle those things because of our walk with God and the word of God. And so that is such an awesome, awesome thing. One last comment I want to make about this that's so important as well is, you know, once your children start hitting around 11 to 14, around that age group, their friends become their family. I mean, they become huge in their mind, and it's all about their friends. Trust me, that's where this thing goes. So if they're younger than 10, all I can say is enjoy it, okay? Because it's going to change, and you're going to be part of their life. But so anyway, here's the deal. You get to choose the peer group that they connect with. By being a part of a local church, you get to put in place that when they become of that age and it's all about their friends, that you're happy about the circle of friends that are around them. Isn't that a great thing? And you get to set that up rather than feeling like, well, I just hope that all works out. I hope there's some decent kids at school or something, but you get to set that in motion. So you know, again, back to church Sunday, it's not about a day, it's not about a visit, it's about a life style that we establish. Well, are we ready for the Word of God this morning? Awesome. Today we're starting a brand new series titled An Enemy Called Average. You know, average is seldom celebrated, isn't it? Average is seldom celebrated. I mean, we don't buy tickets to go hear an average band. You know, we don't buy tickets to go watch. I just want to go watch an average movie with average actors. You know, my wife and I, if we're picking out a movie, she's like, okay, who's acting in it? I don't know those names. Move on, next one. So we don't look for that. You don't go into a restaurant and say, can I just have an average meal? And could you send me the average waiter to take care of me, the average waitress to take care of? I just want average. Average is seldom celebrated. Average is not exactly a great compliment either. I mean, if somebody asked you about your girlfriend, you wouldn't say, well, she's average. And I'm sure the ladies that are here thinking about marriage in the future are out looking for an average guy. If I could just find an average guy. If you are looking for an average guy, you are definitely in the wrong neighborhood, okay? You need to move. There's something wrong. Average is typically disappointing. And the reason is because we're very aware of the faults that make something just average. And, we don't use that word as a demarcation of success or a job well done. We never say to anybody, hey, you know, the band today, didn't they do an average job? We would never use that word in that way. I mean, think about what comes to mind when you hear terms like average employee or average team member, average teenager, average consumer debt, or just average Christians. Average is an equality that God is aiming for in our life. John 10:10 says this, that the thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. This is Jesus speaking. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. Abundantly. Another translation words it this way, life in all its fullness. Or life to the fullest. Life to the fullest. That doesn't sound like average, does it? Life to the fullest. Abundant life. Well, what's that really mean when we break that down? Well, the word abundant is beyond extraordinary. That which is more than. Pertaining to a quality that is so abundant as to be considered more than what one would expect or anticipate. In other words, I wouldn't expect this. It's even better than I expected. And when he uses the word life, it's not about like a living thing in the sense of breathing or existing. It's about vitality. It is about a quality of life. So in other words, abundant life means you're going to have more than expected of things like passion and ambition and drive and motivation and peace and joy in your life, confidence and courage and fortitude. It's those characteristics of the soul, mind, and heart that God says are going to be abundant in your life because of Jesus. That's the life that he has for you. Now, I don't know about you, but that doesn't sound very average. Sometimes in our mind, we hear abundant life, and because of our Western thinking, we can go materialistic and think, oh, abundant life, that's all about all the things that God is going to give me. There's lots of people that have lots of things that are not living an abundant life. They're living an average life, very, very average life. You say, why? Because their average life is full of things like worry and anxiety. They're ruled by fears and insecurities. They're dealing with shame and guilt out of their past. There's confusion. There's conflict in their relationships and a lot of strife going on, you know, in their relationships. They're stressed all the time. They're bitter about how they've been treated. They're discouraged by things they're going through. Listen, that's average. That's average. Abundant life speaks to our inner life, the quality of our soul, heart, and mind. There's nothing average about the life that God has for you, but sadly, too often, people settle for average. Settle for average. Why is average an enemy? It's kind of an interesting title, isn't it? An enemy called it. Why is average an enemy? Here's why average is an enemy. Average is always less than your personal potential. Whatever your potential is, I promise you, average is less than your personal potential because you just always have that ability to be more than that. My sons, when they started to get, you know, part-time jobs and stuff when they were in high school, a couple of them worked for, you know, these auto dealerships as lot boys and things like this. And there was this one job they had where they had this manager, Don was his first name. And so Don one day pulls aside Isaac and another guy to have a chat with him about his philosophy about how they should work there. And my son Joel was working in a different department at the time, but happened to be on site the same day. So here he is. He's in this conversation. Here's what this fellow said to him. He said, listen, guys, here's the thing. You never give 100%. You never give, this is wisdom from the car lot this morning, okay? You never give 100% because if you do, they're always going to expect 100% and you're going to get wore out and discouraged and quit. And so what you do is you give about 60%. Never higher, about 60%. Then if the boss pushes you, you go up to 80%, okay, to impress him. But you never go to 100%. Otherwise, you'll just be exhausted all the time. Just stay at around 60%. Well, as he's sharing this story with Isaac and another friend, my son Joel walks in. He points to him and says, now that guy knows what I'm talking about. Oh, my goodness. The backstory is he knew because he'd already heard that speech from him before. They didn't know that. I thought it was hilarious. Okay, moving right along. Average. Average is a lie that tells you it's good enough when it could be so much better. Average is a lie. It says, you know, that's good. It's good enough. But it could be. It could be so much better. Think about that. If you're a person who's bound to average, if you're satisfied with average, what that means is there's 50% more doing better than you. In other words, it really could be a whole lot better. Average robs you from what could be by accepting what is. It robs you from what could be by accepting what is. It tends to endorse a sense of status quo. Well, it's average, so it's okay. We can go with this, but there's this what could be that you miss out on. Average is often the lowest common denominator. Why? Because average is about the crowd. Average is about, we've got to please everybody, so we're going to be making some compromises so we can keep everybody happy. We want to have an average where everybody can be happy, and that usually means going to the lowest common denominator in order to please the crowd or the majority in those situations and make a lot of compromises. Average is always a lesser moral position. A lesser moral position. Why? Because we use phrases like this. Well, everybody does it. Everybody does it. You ever been a parent who's telling your child, I don't want you doing it? Everybody does it. Right. Average is the lesser moral position. Everybody talks this way. Everybody thinks this way. Average sabotages excellence. Average sabotages excellence. And you know, here's the difference between average and excellence. It's important to understand this. Excellence is doing the best with what you have. Okay? And that is such an important description of what excellence is, because if you don't go there, your head can go to comparison and looking at other people and looking at other situations that really you should not be doing. Average is doing the best with what you have. So no matter what your skills are, your talents, your possess, all of those things, it's taking those things and going, you know what? I'm just going to give this my personal best. And when you do that, you will come into excellence. You will come in above average. Because here's what average is. Average is doing what anybody could have done. Wow. Now, how do we win over this enemy called average? Number one, avoid comparison to others. Avoid comparison to others. Average is your enemy because it gets you into a mentality of comparison. And here's what we do when we compare ourselves to others and we accept average is we look at the group, not individuals. Right. And so we look and we say, well, here's the crowd, here's the majority, here's what most people are doing. So that must be the average, that must be acceptable, that must be okay. So I think that's what I should do. If you look at your family and you're like, how's our family doing? And you're saying, well, we're doing okay, like compared to, what are you going to compare to? You're going to compare to the average family. You're going to think in terms of group. You're not going to think about super dad. You're not going to think about the Wonder Woman mom. Right? You're not going to think about those people. You're going to think about, well, what's the average family doing? We're okay. We're average. It's great. Or you think about the average employee. How am I doing at the job? Well, I think about the average employee around here. I think about the average work ethic, the average attitude. I think I'm an average employee. I think I'm doing okay. You don't compare yourself to employee of the month. Right? You think about, when you think about comparison, you tend to go to the average. And so we don't tend to think about who's the leader, who's the elite, who's the champion, who's the star, who's the record breaker. I need to, you know, go for that. We instead are tempted to justify our behavior in comparison to the group. 2 Corinthians 10:12 says this: we do not dare to classify or compare ourselves with some who commend themselves. When they measure themselves by themselves and compare themselves with themselves, they are not wise. So why is it not wise to get into this comparison thing? Because first of all, you're an individual and you have individual responsibilities and gifts and abilities and strengths and weaknesses, and you have your own favors that are on your life and your own challenges as well in your own life and all of that, and your own purpose and destiny, and all of that is unique. And so why would I get into comparison to an average when I actually have a calling that is unique? And what I'm saying is for everybody. Everybody has a circumstance and a situation and a calling that is unique. So why would I want to compare myself to an average? I need to press into what God has called me to do. God has called me to be the best version of me, not the best version of me compared to. And so comparison will allow average to be a standard when you, in fact, can have a potential that is so much higher than average. And yet we allow that to justify ourselves. So if I'm going to go into comparison, because I think there is a healthy comparison that you can use, if I'm going to go into comparison, how can I make comparison actually work for me instead of justifying my less than excellent behavior? Here's what we do. First of all, first standard to compare to is Jesus. Jesus. Why? Because you are predestined to be conformed into his image. That is part, when you give your life to Christ, God's intention is to restore you back to the person that he originally created to, you were created to be. You were made in the image of God. Sin has made us into a broken image, a fallen image. Now Christ comes into our life and God begins to do a work to bring us back to what he had originally intended. In other words, if you're going through life and you're like, man, I've got these habits, you know, I've got these faults about my life. I find myself getting angry with people all the time. I find myself impatient all the time. I find myself, you know, always needing a drink to handle my stress or whatever. Know this, God did not originally intend for you to be that way. All of those things are the product of sin. It's the brokenness that we have in our life. Now we give our life to Jesus. He wants to do a healing work and a changing work in our soul to restore us into God's intentional image. That is your destiny. That is where you're going. That's why we're to do what? Keep our eyes on Jesus. That's where we're heading. 2 Corinthians 3:18 says, "We all, with unveiled faces, behold as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as from the Lord the Spirit." He says, listen, as you're looking to Jesus, it's like you're looking into a mirror. And when you looked into a mirror this morning, you saw two things in your mind. In your mind, you had an image of what should be. Well, in the mirror, you saw what is. And then you work to change what is into what should be. Right. Well, you know what? That's what it's like when we follow Jesus. As we're walking with him, as we're opening God's word, as we're seeing God's promises and God's ways and getting to know the Lord, we're seeing, as in a mirror, what should be in our life. But it also reflects what it is that God wants to change in us. And so there's a comparison that we need to embrace. Here's another comparison to actually embrace, and that is comparing yourself to yourself. Yeah. Comparing yourself to yourself. Being able to say, where was I a year ago? Where am I now? Can I say that I've moved forward in my journey with God? Can I say that I'm doing better in things that used to really be a challenge? Can I say that there's progress? Because if I can, I know I'm on the journey the way I should be. Right. But if I look at myself and I go, man, there's less spiritual passion. I don't read my Bible like I used to. I am passive in worship. I am flipping about even attendance at a church. Or I just seem to have a lot more interest. And then we'd really have to look at ourselves and say, you know what? I need to deal with my life, make some changes, make some decisions, make sure I'm on track and pressing in for God's best in my life and not allowing myself to get distracted or robbed in any way, comparing myself to myself. Here's the last comparison that can actually work for you. Instead of comparing yourself to the crowd, compare yourself to examples. To examples. Throughout your journey of life, you will meet people who are an example. You're gonna meet a husband and you're gonna go, man, that guy, look how he parents. Look how he talks to his kids. That is awesome. I didn't grow up around that. I need to embrace that. I'm gonna take that. Yep. See, that's what you do through life. You meet examples and you rip them off. Yep. Totally. That's totally what you do. You know, God gave you eyes, plagiarize. You know what I'm saying? Notice I said examples. It's not about one person. If you have a mentality that says, oh, I'm looking for that one person that's going to be my example, my mentor or whatever, nah, that doesn't exist. Doesn't exist. Instead, realize that there are multiple people in your world and you need to look at the strengths that are happening in their life, the example that they are to you, where you can embrace something that you see about them and go, man, I want to have that in my life. Man, I want to live like, and I'm telling you, this principle absolutely works to grow your relationship with God and grow yourself as a person and develop your life. Okay, number two. Live a generous life. Live a generous life. I got to keep things moving here. I got excited on number one. In relationships, don't be average. Be generous. Average people settle for their rights. I have a right to be fair. I feel like I have a right to get even. I feel even like I have a right to be offended. Don't settle for your rights. Be above average. Matthew chapter 5, verse 38. I'm going to walk you through a big chunk of scripture here and pause and talk as we go about a generous life. Here's what Jesus had to say. You've heard it said, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, do not resist an evil person. Whoever slaps you on the right cheek, turn the other to him also. In other words, Jesus is saying, don't be like the average people trying to get even. Why don't you be bigger than that? Why don't you be bigger than getting offended and just treat it like it never even happened? If anyone wants to sue you and take your shirt, what kind of a shirt are you wearing? Yeah. Yeah. Seriously, I'm going to talk to my lawyer. I want your shirt. If anyone wants to sue you and take your shirt, let them have your coat also. In other words, if somebody's being petty, be bigger than them. Be bigger than them. Average person would get offended and then want to get even. Eye for eye, tooth for tooth is actually Old Testament, and it was meant to be a legal boundary. In other words, if we have to do something judicial here, you can't take more than what was taken from you. But instead, it became license where people changed their attitude and decided, I have a right to get even because the scripture says eye for eye and tooth for tooth. Generous people focus on harmony over offense through generous mercy. Then he goes on and says, whoever forces you to go with him 1 mile, go with them two. Go with them two. It's a popular phrase, go the extra mile, still in our society today. Go with them two. Give to him who asks of you. Do not turn away from him who wants to borrow from you. Do you know what average people do? Average people only fulfill their obligations. What do I have to do? What must I do? What is my obligation? What this scripture is talking about was a law that was around at the time where if a soldier was passing through town, they could ask any civilian to carry their belongings for 1 mile. They had a right to do that, and that civilian had the responsibility and the obligation to do what they were asked to do. You have to do this mile of walking with me and carrying my things. And Jesus comes along and says, don't live your life just with the obligation. Why don't you be generous? Why don't you be generous? Average people will only do what they have to. Exceeding average means exceeding their expectations. Do you notice this? It doesn't take very much to be above average. It really doesn't take. Jesus said, why don't you just go an extra mile? He didn't say, go 2 or 3. He didn't tell him, go 10 miles. He said, why don't you just go 1 extra mile? It doesn't take much to be above average. You know, a lot of times 1 mile just means a gesture of kindness to somebody. A lot of times the extra mile is just giving somebody a compliment or a word of encouragement when you could have said nothing. The extra mile is just a little more effort, just a little more attention. It's sometimes the extra mile is just choosing to have a good attitude, choosing to have a good work ethic, choosing to do a little bit more than was expected for the team and in participation and all the rest of it. It doesn't take much to be above average. You've heard it said, back to Jesus, you have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. That's average. That's average, isn't it? I love my neighbor. I don't love that other neighbor, but I love this one. But I say to you, love your enemies. Pray for those who persecute you so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven. What does he do? For he causes the sun to rise on the evil and the good, and he sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. God is generous regardless of the recipient. He doesn't look and say, what kind of person have you been? He just says, I am generous in nature. I'm going to be generous to you regardless of who you are. Jesus says, that's what I want you to do. I want you to be like your heavenly Father. I want you to love people that love you and love people that don't love you. Average people look for the minimum. They limit themselves to the minimum. What is the minimum that I need to do? And Jesus said, exceed it. Aim to exceed the expectations of others through generosity. Aim to exceed the expectations of others through generosity. Be generous with mercy when you could be offended. Be generous with service when you could limit yourself to what are the obligations? I'll just stay there. Be generous with love towards people that are outside of your circle. Generosity takes you beyond average. Number 3, don't settle, but keep moving forward. Don't settle, keep moving forward. What do average people do? They arrive at some station partway to where they're going and settle. Well, far enough. It's enough effort. Acts chapter 7 talks about Abraham's journey And I want to read it for you, and I want you to pay particularly attention to what God was saying and where he was saying it, and to the geography a little bit that's in here. To this he replied, "Brothers and fathers, listen to me. The God of glory appeared to our father Abraham while he was still in Mesopotamia, before he lived in Haran. Leave your country and your people," God said, "and go to the land that I will show you." So he left the land of the Chaldeans and settled in Haran. After the death of his father, God sent him into the land where we are now. Now, let's go back to Genesis 11 and read a little bit about this. You're going to notice the name changing from Abraham to Abram. The reason is because his name was Abram. God changed it to Abraham. We're not no time to get into all the why and the what about that, but just so you understand, we're talking about the same person. Terah took his son Abram and his grandson Lot, son of Haran, and his daughter-in-law Sarai, who became Sarah, the wife of his son Abram, and together they sent out from Ur of the Chaldees to go to Canaan. But when they came to Haran, they settled there. Abraham was clearly told by God to leave his family and leave his country. He says, I want you on a journey. I'm taking you to a new place. You're going to be the father of nations. There's this big deal going on. But you need to leave your country and you need to leave your family for me to get done what I need to get done with you. God had a plan. God had a purpose. Abraham compromised. Abraham settled for partial obedience. Well, I'll go, but I'm going to take the fam with me. I'm going to take Dad. I'm going to take Lot. And what was the result of that? He got part way to where God wanted him to go. He got to this place called Haran, and he settled for less than what God wanted. He settled in Haran. Why did he settle? Because his compromise became his leader. His compromise was to take his father, Terah. Terah ends up taking over leadership, and as you read the wording in Genesis, it's like you would think God spoke to Terah to leave to go to Haran. You know, I'm going to take Abram, I'm going to take Sarah, I'm going to take Lot, let's all go, hold it. God spoke to Abraham, not to you. But that's what happens when we compromise. Our compromise begins to take leadership in places where it shouldn't be taking leadership. Furthermore, after they'd been in Haran and waited for Dad to die before they could move on, you need to know this. The Terah's actual meaning of his name is the word delay. Wow. And when we are partial with our obedience and we make compromises, we delay the purposes of God for our life. When we settle for partial obedience, we delay God's purposes. And it wasn't until this guy dies that Abraham can now go forward and move on with his life. His compromise became his delay, and his delay caused him to settle at a place that was less than what God had for him. Okay, application time. Here's the question. Where have you settled? Where have you settled? Where have you settled maybe in your marriage? Where, you know, marriage is meant to be, you know, this lifelong relationship with your best friend, and it's meant to be happy, it's meant to be fun, it's meant to be joyful, it's meant to be a journey. And maybe you've settled at, well, we don't throw pots and pans anymore. Maybe you've settled at, he has a TV room and I have a TV room. Maybe that's where you've settled. Where have you settled? Maybe it's settled just into dull and routine, and you need to break out of your boredom. Go do something fun for a change. You know, like you did when you were trying to win her. Anyway, moving right along. Said the single guy. Settle. Maybe you've settled for an okay career, but you know you've got a whole lot more potential inside of you. And it's just about determining not to procrastinate, not to be lazy, not to put off, but to decide, I am going to develop my skills, my abilities. I want to get into the career that I love rather than the career that's okay. Maybe you've settled for success in life, but it's only in one area. Typically what happens in this dynamic is people settle for business success or financial success while their family is you know, going to pot and going down the, and their marriage is about to tank. But at least I've got success in my business and business is booming and that's awesome. And why have you settled for success in one dimension? One dimension. It can be the other way too, because you know, you can be someone who says, well, you know what, I'm failing with finances and I can't seem to keep a job, but we're a happy family. Yeah, you're a happy family, but you're living on the verge of being very unhappy. Success in life should be holistic. It's about a journey of peace and victory in every area of our life. Don't settle for partial success. How about in your personal life? Where have you settled? Have you settled in your walk with God with partial victory? Well, there's some things I used to do and used to be, and I don't do those anymore. Yeah, but what about the habits that you're still doing that you haven't determined that you should get a victory over, and yet God's intention is that you do? Yeah.
Right.
Have you settled? Have you settled? Philippians 1:6 says this, "Be confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus." In other words, whatever is unfinished in you, God is committed to complete. And he is not going, yeah, you've made some changes, but that's good enough. No, God's like, hey, we're not done yet. Keep looking in the mirror called the Bible. Keep looking at Jesus. Keep looking at that, reflecting what can still change. Let me continue to work with you to make you more and more like him. We're still on the journey. Don't settle. What God began, he wants to complete. He wants to finish. Don't say things like, well, it'll always be this way. I mean, I've always been a moody, depressed kind of person. I've always been, you know, impatient and angry with people. I've always had strife in my family. I've always been, you know, disappointed and discouraged in life. And, you know, I've always turned to substance for relief from my stress. That's just the way it is. No, you're settling. That's the language of settling. And God is not settling with you. He's behind you pushing, saying, come on, this can change. You can do better. There is more. There's an abundant life. Don't rob yourself. Where have you settled in your walk with God? You know, the reason why when I use the word average Christian, people go, oh, because we realize that a lot of times average Christian has a gap of about a mile between that and what we read in the book of Acts. And here's why. Because people have settled for a faith in Jesus as their Savior without a surrender to Jesus as the Lord of their life. And it's a pseudo-Christianity. We can settle like Abraham and be in partial obedience. But instead of that, God says, no, that's not the life I have for you. I want you to have an abundant life. Don't settle. Instead, embrace everything. Instead of settling, surrender. When it comes to your walk with God, instead of settling, yeah, this is just kind of the way it is, and in my experience, would you, no, don't redefine Jesus by your experience. Instead, surrender fully to Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior and decide, I'm going to follow him with all my heart. I'm going to give the same passion towards following Jesus that I have given towards other things in life and even more. And when we don't settle like that, we engage God and engage his promises and engage the abundant life that God really wants in our life. Let's stand as we take time to pray, begin to close. I want to give opportunity for you to respond to this, that maybe today you look and you're that person who says, you know what? I've settled for Jesus as Savior, but I've not surrendered to Jesus as Lord. And we don't want you to be living in Haran when God has a promised land for you. You know, the other thing is maybe in your walk with God, you can look and you go, you know, I've got my terror that I brought along with me. I've got that thing in my life that's causing me to delay on the purposes of God in my life. And it's time to stop living in partial obedience. It's time to stop carrying things along with you that you need to be releasing so that you can move forward into the fullness of what God has and the purposes that he has for your life. So I want us to bow all over this place where we just take a moment to pray. First, I want to pray for people that would say, Pastor, you know what? I've settled for Jesus as Savior. But today, I'm going to surrender to Jesus as Lord. You know, if that's you, I'm just going to invite you to pray along with me right where you're standing. And I just want to ask if you would just to give me a wave right now to say, you know what, include me in that prayer, Pastor. Include me in that prayer. Just give me a wave. Include me in that prayer. Awesome. Thank you, guys. Thank you as well. Anybody else, you say, man, I've been settling for Jesus as Savior. I need to surrender today to Jesus Christ as the Lord of my life. Awesome. You can put your hands down. Let's pray with those who are responding right now. Lord Jesus, I thank you that you died for me and you paid for my past. But I thank you as well that you want to walk with me into my future, that you have a plan and you have a purpose for my life as I follow you. And so today I surrender to Jesus as Lord, to follow you with all of my heart, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Father, I pray for others that are here today that recognize a Terah in their life, something that they've been bringing along, something they've kept, some partial obedience that has caused delay, that has kept them from the best of what you have. Father, in the name of Jesus, today we're saying no more. Today we're saying we surrender that, we're repenting of that, we're turning from that. We are saying today, Father, that we are following you fully, not partially. We're not carrying along things that will delay our walk and experience in our relationship with you. Thank you, Jesus, that your promise is for an abundant life. And may we embrace and experience that in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen. You guys may be seated. If you're somebody today that just prayed that prayer along with Pastor Dennis today to say yes to Jesus as your Lord and Savior, we want to celebrate that with you. We want to help you. This is the biggest decision you've ever made in your life. And we don't make big decisions with no follow-up. Right, you don't buy a ring and then not give it to her. You make the big decision and you follow through. And so we want to help you with the follow through. We don't want to leave you just with the decision. So what we'd love for you to do is to take that Connect card we talked about earlier in the service today and fill out the backside to say I've committed or I've recommitted my life to Christ today. And you can head to our guest services again. And we would love to meet you and have a conversation to help you to know, where do you go from here? This is just the beginning, and we're so excited for you today. And so we're going to take up our giving as a church this morning. And so there's multiple ways you can do so. In the envelope in the seat back in front of you, there's our self-serve giving stations in the lobby. There's our app. There's our website. There's lots of ways to do so. And so we invite you now to get your offering ready. And then I'm going to pray for our giving. We're going to jump on our feet. We're going to sing one more song and thank Jesus for all you did today. So, Lord, we thank you for the word that you spoke to us today. God, I pray that if there's something inside of us that you stirred as the word was spoken, that we wouldn't just leave it there, that we would listen, that we would act upon the terrors that we need to deal with in our life today. And so, Lord, as we give to you today, we thank you that you're going to give back to us. Lord, we thank you that we cannot outgive God. Lord, you've given us everything. So today we act in obedience and we give to you, and we do it all in the name of Jesus. Amen. You may jump to your feet as we sing.